I, Jason, gets more than 13 seconds of airtime, I get to chat at you during this break about my feelings on Google Stadia, the next great streaming game service. What do I think about it? Find out right now on Orange VoiceOver Radio.
Orange Lounge Radio.
Google Stadia, Google's first great foray into non-mobile gaming. Stadia officially released the week of November 18th. Depending on where you live and your circumstances, you likely received it someday that week. My account setup email came out on Wednesday, which I promptly opened and set up, waiting anxiously for the Stadia package to arrive the next day, and it did. The Stadia package arrived on Thursday while I was still working. I did open it up, inspect all the contents, take initial notes on all the hardware, and plugged in the controller to charge it just in case I decided to use it wirelessly. You receive your color choice of a very typical-looking console controller with a slight difference in buttons. There's a double row of menu buttons on the top of the front face of the controller, a Stadia button located in the same place as the PlayStation button on PlayStation-style controllers. It has PlayStation-style analog sticks parallel at the bottom, yet Microsoft-style face buttons, A on bottom, Y on top. There is also the requisite physical documentation with the lightest of details, a Chromecast Ultra and its power brick. The most noteworthy detail in all of this was that the Chromecast's power brick has an Ethernet port in it, which was neat. I've since learned this is a standard feature of the Chromecast Ultra, but I've never used that before I received it in this package, so it's still neat. I had a bunch of things to do on Thursday after I was done working, so the bulk of my review time wasn't particularly extensive. It was only about a little bit over an hour. As I do with all new systems, I spent the first amount of time going through the menus, and the first point of contention I faced was that when you use Stadia.com on a PC, you have no access to the Stadia store. Both Stadia.com and playing via the Chromecast tell you to open the app to manage your Stadia library or purchase games. So, I pull up my phone and claim the first two free Stadia Pro subscriber games, Samurai Showdown, naturally the 2019 release, and Destiny 2, The Collection. Given the lack of time I had Thursday night, I opted for Samurai Showdown because I probably wouldn't even get through character creation in Destiny 2. Based off how plain Destiny went, I was correct in that assumption. Google has a gigantic leg up on content service providers. Their history, growth, and optimization for all things networking means that they have data centers around the world, close to major internet hubs, and in some cases even closer to consumers. This capacity is immense for their purposes alone, and grows even larger still since they sell it to customers via Google Cloud. And then there's the technical proficiency of the tools in use. Their stewardship of the VP9 codec, the video codec they encode every YouTube video into, among others, means that they have gigantic amounts of source materials and tools to encode, stream, and leverage the codec's capability. I assume Stadia's output is VP9. I don't actually know. There's been nothing in the Stadia interface that actually reports this. There's no technical details right-click option that I noticed, and I haven't done the research for it yet. But if they don't use VP9 for this, I would be very surprised. So, my Stadia controller had already been plugged in and was charging. I had to install Chrome in order to access Stadia.com on this PC, as I hadn't yet. And upon starting Samurai Showdown, I immediately ran into something peculiar. When you hit a button on any controller in Samurai Showdown for the first time, it displays the confirmation that the device is in use. I had accidentally hit a key on the keyboard, and it said keyboard connected. And then when I used the Stadia controller, it said Player 2's controller is connected. Player 2. And, unsurprisingly, Player 2's controller is not able to navigate the menus, so the Stadia controller was doing effectively nothing in-game. Okay, I have a lot of accessories plugged into this PC. Is it Player 2 because the keyboard was pressed first? Close the game, log back into it, hit the controller first. Nope. Still Player 2 controller connected. Look around at all my obvious things. My VR controllers are shut off. I do have the Xbox wireless adapter plugged in. Might have to remove that. Oh, wait a second. My Xbox One controller didn't land on the dock correctly, so it was still on. Okay, shut that off, restart the game just because of habits. And now the Stadia controller connects for Player One. Hooray! This was an immediate realization that the Stadia controller is seemingly not necessary. The upfront $129 cost for Stadia now feels excessive, but more on that in a little bit. Samurai Showdown played well. There were no glaring visual imperfections to speak of. I could tell a minor fuzzing and shine that I know has to do with re-encoding into lossy codecs, but only because I'm looking for it. Only because I'm really staring at the sharp edge of static lines and text. If you want an example of what this is and why it is, I recommend Tom Scott's video, Why Snow and Confetti Ruin YouTube Video Quality. The weirdest thing about this is load times in the game. Between battles, there's still a 3 to 5 second load time. Whenever I think of a server-backed system, I immediately expect the server to be powerful. More powerful than my PC, more powerful than whatever system I'm using to access it. The load time is likely no worse than it would be if locally on my PC, and giving every player a super-powered PC doesn't really scale to the number of players I assume Google hopes to achieve with this. So, makes sense. The controls for Samurai Showdown felt a little rigid, but I think that's intentional. Samurai Showdown historically has always been a bit more strict, more so than Street Fighter, way less floaty than Super Smash Bros. But granted, this is also an assumption. I haven't played Samurai Showdown since the original Neo Geo version, and I was never any good at it. This isn't something that I can compare a feel against, because that varies from game to game. And again, I don't have enough experience with Samurai Showdown. This is something that's going to be best determined by something that I'm adequately experienced with, and as of this writing, the only games that I've played outside of Stadia in its library are Thumper and Trials Rising, and I'm not really interested in rebuying games. And that's a pretty big sticking point for me. I consider the library to be one of Stadia's two elephants in the room. I don't like the purchasing model. Google Play should sell these games directly. This was my biggest complaint about OnLive, because if they fold and I lose my library, that hurts. And as far as I'm aware, that's exactly what happened. I didn't lose anything at the time because they were waiving subscription charges, and I just used the 30-minute free trials of all of the games that they offered. I never bought anything directly through OnLive. But all of this comes through as being a digital purchaser. I've used Steam since its release in 2004. I can't tell you the last time I bought a boxed PC game. Since about 2 to 3 years into the 3DS's life, and this entire generation of gaming consoles, I have a strictly digital library. No Xbox discs, no PS4 discs, no Switch cartridges. Okay, that's a lie. I have a disc of Titanfall for the Xbox One, but that's because I wanted the limited edition box and the game came with, but it's still shrink-wrapped. And I already own the game digitally. I have a high degree of confidence in Microsoft and Sony's staying power. I had little confidence in OnLive's staying power, and I'm on the fence about Google's continued support of Stadia, so I'm kind of torn. And this doesn't apply to Game Pass nor PS Now. Those are both in addition to something you already have. For Game Pass, you already have a PC or an Xbox One. For PS Now, you already have a PlayStation or a Vita or a PlayStation TV. Do those still work if you already own them? I don't actually know. But on that fact, the PlayStation TV, a product, died before PS Now, the service, did. Game Pass and PlayStation Now can persist as long as those two companies are still in the gaming business. And even if those services go away, there's a fallback. They still offer their digital library for use on hardware directly. So then, what is Stadia's fallback? I don't know of one that already exists. I don't know if they've said there will be one. I do hope one comes. So, going back to the $129 upfront cost, when you sit back and add it up, it's not unreasonable. For $129, you get a controller, $40, a Chromecast Ultra, $70, Stadia Pro for 3 months, which is a $30 value so far as they've announced so far. I'm not paying for Stadia Pro until February 2020. It does seem like Google is taking a bit of a loss here. I do think that allowing people that already have a game controller and a PC, which is many people, to pay $10 and just start playing games would have been a great decision on their part. After all, the point here is to not need powerful hardware. Okay, enough about all this. Let's play some games. Yeah, Samurai Showdown played well. I made it through a handful of rounds against CPU opponents. I dared not play human opponents because I'm not good at fighting games. And I didn't want to focus my attention on battles. I wanted to focus my attention on everything else that Stadia is offering about this experience. My first round of playing was on a Windows PC, Ethernet wired directly into my router, using the Stadia controller via Google Chrome. And it held up really well. As I said, I also played with my Xbox controller, which also worked, albeit without the convenience features the Stadia controller has for simple game exiting, nor the ability to take quick screenshots and game clips, and so on and so forth. I don't know what more I can say here. Stadia held up on my network. I use Comcast, it's rated at 85 megabits per second as an average download speed, sub 20 millisecond latency, all of this to some speed test server that my router uses. And this is also on Amplify router equipment. I played a game, and it felt good, which for being on some server somewhere reasonably geographically close to me, I assume, is a good sign. My second round, I played Destiny. I have played through the story of Destiny 1. I enjoy and play a lot of first-person shooters, and this is probably more representative. Not only this, but this was also done on Stadia via the Chromecast, and I did not plug in an Ethernet cable. I had slightly lower hopes for this because I know wireless latency, but I was still really pleased with the result. I set up my character, I did the opening Guardian revival wake-up and the initial quest to make it to the city, and there were one or two points in which the quality stuttered a tiny little bit in random moments, not like too much going on the screen, anything like that. I didn't notice if this actually impacted my inputs. It was only notable for output video frame stutter, frame drops actually, and there were at least 2 to 3 occasions where the output video quality dropped. It was either a bitrate drop or a 4K downgrade to 1080p, maybe both. I also was not playing this on a 4K TV, so I'm not sure. Again, there's no technical indicators on the game screen to tell you anything like this, at least as far as I've encountered. There might be some indicator if the output channel fails outright for some reason, but that hasn't happened in my admittedly only few hours of playing so far. The cute part of Stadia, socially speaking, was that the group of Guardians that I crossed paths with in the opening sequence showed up in my recent players section of the iOS app. Cute. That said, I have not yet played Stadia via my phone nor a tablet. So Stadia isn't bad, network conditions permitting. If you have quality internet and network equipment, but lack any other high-powered devices, be those being a console or a sufficiently powered PC, this could be a huge boon for you. I don't expect it to be an overwhelming success, because the players that would choose to use it are a subset of players that will put money into this hobby and don't already have a console, don't have an up-to-date PC for these modern games, etc. But those players definitely exist. For me, I need to go make some progress in Death Stranding. So, back to you, Studio N7.